to do Fred Diller's talk there for a second, which was a little worrying. But anyway, so thank you very much for the introduction. I'm very pleased to be here. So most people think of Public Library of Science as an open access publisher, and of course that's at the centre of our mission. But more broadly, we're interested, like many of the publishers who've spoken today, in using the online tools and resources that we have at our disposal to just make the whole business of scholarly communication more effective. And we launched an article level metrics program last year, last March, so it's still relatively new, and this is very much connected with that broader mission, that broader kind of interpretation of our mission. So I'm going to say just a very few words about PLOS and then go straight into article level metrics and talk about why we've done what we've done, how we did it, and where we're going next. A couple of things to note. We're publishers, that's our core competency, so we're not experts in data analysis. So we haven't gone as far, for example, as our last speaker in terms of the analysis of the data. But also, article level metrics, this is something that's relevant to all publishers. It's not an open access issue. And just a couple of acknowledgements. Pete Binfield, a colleague at PLOS, he's really been spearheading article level metrics from an editorial standpoint. And Rich Cave, who's our IT director, and his team have developed the tools that I'm going to talk about. So just very briefly, who are we? We became an open access publisher in 2003. So we're relatively new. We're a web native, in a sense. Although I'm not a web native, but anyway, well, the organization is. Primarily, you know, our business model is a publication fee business model, so that supports our publishing activity. We're the largest not-for-profit open access publisher. We have seven journals, but one of those journals is really big, PLOS One, and is already the third biggest journal in the world. We're based in San Francisco, and as Maya said, I'm based in Cambridge in the UK, where we have an editorial office. So the theme is, who cares about, is measuring impact, and of course everyone cares about this. And the point I just wanted to make here is that everyone looks at it differently. Everyone has different kinds of questions that they want to ask. So the business of measuring impact, it's a multifaceted problem, it's a complicated problem. So how do we do it? Well, we distill it down to a number, as we've heard, and you know there are some real limitations to what we're doing here by essentially judging the worth of a paper in terms of the journal in which it happens to be published, and specifically the impact factor of that journal. I won't dwell on the negative aspects of that, and I think we're going to hear a little bit more about that later, actually. But the good news is that it doesn't have to be this way. And so we feel that rather than this sort of paradigm of measuring the value of articles by the journal in which it happens to be published, that there's a huge amount to be gained by thinking at the article level and to judging articles on their own merits. So there are a number of tools that can be brought to bear, a number of metrics and indicators, as we've heard, and they're listed there. And so essentially that's what we've tried to do. We've tried to provide metrics and indicators along these lines. And also, you know, current technology allows us to do this relatively easily. So as I say, we're trying to provide a range of metrics, and I'll demonstrate that in a second, what we've actually done. The metrics are all at the article level for all of the PLOS journals. One point is that these aren't just also useful for scholarly evaluation. They can be potentially very useful tools for navigating the literature and organizing and filtering literature. So they have these metrics can be used in other ways as well. And just the final point is that there's nothing new. Obviously, you know, PLOS isn't the first publisher to do this, but the kind of the range of metrics that we're making openly available is probably something that where we are taking a reasonably pioneering role. And I mentioned the other Michael Jensen, the one at the National Academies Press, because he published, I think, a really, really nice article in Chronicle of Higher Ed, you know, 2.5 years ago. And it goes much further than we've gone, but it's visionary in terms of, you know, how the online medium can be used for these purposes. So now I'm just going to run through a set of screenshots just to give you a sense of how it works and what we've done. So this is a typical article. It's a PLOS One article. So you can see this tabbed article design at the top. And one of these tabs is called metrics. So you can open that tab, and the first thing you see are usage metrics. So actually, one point to make in relation to the last talk, unlike SSRN, the first view you come to at PLOS is the article in all its glory. So you see a full text version of the article. So there's no abstract view, and from there you can go to the PDF. You can also download the XML, which some people are interested in doing. So we break down usage into those three things, and we show a graph of what the cumulative usage looks like. And if you mouse over one of those little bubbles there, you see that what the usage was in that particular month. If you scroll further down the page, then now you're into citation information. At the moment, we're providing citation information from three sources: Scopus, PubMed Central, and Crossref. We hope to add Web of Science soon. If you click on one of those links, so it gives you a number, it tells you how many times it's been cited. If you click on one of those links, and actually this is a different article now, but basically you get a landing page, a list of all the articles that have cited the original article. Going further down, users can rate the articles in PLOS journals according to various properties, which are insight, reliability, and style, and then an overall rating is given. Now, this is a feature that is, it turns out, used on only a pretty small minority of articles, actually, so it's not particularly heavily used at the moment. But anyway, it's there as well as another indicator. And again, if you click that, then you find the individual ratings of the people who've rated the article, along with any comments they've added. Going a bit further down, another thing users can do with PLOS content is add notes and comments to the article. So we provide a link to the notes and comments that have been added as well, and a landing page for those. The next thing is social bookmarks. So these are tools like Connoteer and CiteYouLike are the two that we work with. And if you're not familiar with these tools, essentially they're resources which can be used to help you manage your bibliographies. And so, you might think that if someone records a particular article in their CiteYouLike library, that indicates a certain, maybe an intention to perhaps to cite that article ultimately. But anyway, so we give data on that, and another landing page, so you can see this is the article that's been bookmarked and what else is this person bookmarked underneath. And again, that gets into the idea of the tools can be used for navigation purposes as well. And then the final thing is blog coverage. So we give a sense of how much this article has been covered in the blogosphere, and we use blog aggregation services. Dan mentioned Nature blogs this morning, and so services like that which aggregate and improve the linking from the blog to the article, we can use to show how much blogosphere coverage there's been. And again, this is the article, it's been blogged by all these various people in the post-genomic aggregation service. So that's essentially what we've done, provided this data. It's all openly available. The way we did it is we've got an open source publishing platform that's homegrown, and so we've developed the tool, which we call an article level metrics app. It's an open source tool with our internal development team. For the usage data, we had the problem of using multiple sources of data. It was complicated. The usage data was a lot of work to get that displayed. So it took a fair amount of work. We have used the best available standard, which is Counter, although Counter is really designed as a tool to report journal level metrics, journal level usage data, particularly for librarians, and so it's not ideal for these purposes. And so one of the things we did, we expanded the list of robots that are excluded beyond what's listed in Counter, and that list is available if you're interested. But there is definitely the need for more standards. And then as far as the other data is, essentially there's this kind of growing group of resources out there that provide APIs, so you can make calls from your article to these various services, and then data is returned back, which you can display on the article. So that's how it works. So in order for that to happen, the resources such as CiteYouLike or Connoteer or whatever it is need an open API, which then we can send the query to. Our goal then is to provide a sort of a data point, so how many times has this been cited, blogged, whatever, and then go to a landing page, as I've shown. So that's how we've done it. The APIs that we've used, there's a document available which summarizes all of this, and anyone that's interested is welcome to see that. Be happy to help. So how's this been received? Just to give you a sense, so we launched phase one in March. We added the usage data, which was phase two in September, so it's all pretty new still. The reaction, though, has been uniformly positive, and clearly authors, you know, like this. It appeals to them. So, you know, the first person says, you know, your innovation is extremely promising. We're hopeful that this will transform the way that impact is assessed for published articles. Well, absolutely, that's what we hope to. And then the second one's interesting because this is a case where an author has submitted an article to another PLOS journal and have cited their usage data in this case on their previously published papers to sort of support the fact that they've published papers with us that have been highly downloaded. Not that that would have influenced the editorial decision, of course, but you know, it's interesting to see how this is being used. And another example, an article in the Times Higher Ed, which is about a paper in a piece in PLOS Biology, which was to do with the whole business of grant writing and the kind of bureaucracy associated with it and how out of hand it's become, particularly in the UK. And the quote in this further down was, "The piece has been downloaded from the journal's website more than 20,000 times, suggesting that it struck a chord with the Academy." So again, sort of interesting to see these spontaneous uses of these of the data that we're providing. Now, as I said at the beginning, we're not data experts, so one of the things that we want to try and achieve is to just make this data available so that people smarter than us can tell us, well, you know, this bit's no good, you know, you need to improve this, or you need to add another kind of data over here. So what we've done is we've made an entire Excel spreadsheet available for the whole data set. And it is being downloaded, which is good to see. And here's just a chunk of it. And so, you know, it's being downloaded. And so, for example, one person tweeted the following. This person says, "So quantifying my insignificance, I'm the sixth author on the 8,578th most heavily accessed article in PLOS." Not terribly informative, but, you know, again, it just shows you that people are, you know, as Greg said, paying attention. But you really want to provide a bit more context, a bit more help, so that people can interpret this data a little bit. So we've tried to do that by providing some summary data at the journal level. So, for example, for each journal, so in PLOS Genetics, if you had a research article published in 2006, which is the left-hand red arrow, then on average, research articles published in that year have been down, have accumulated usage of 3,800. And so, you know, if your article is more or less than that, then you kind of know, roughly speaking, where you are in relation to the average. And similarly, we've done the same thing for different fields as well. So different fields, the download averages are different. So again, we've provided that as extra context. The other thing that's happened, which we're pleased to have seen, is the downloading of the entire data set and people sort of playing with it and beginning to use it. So this chap, Michael Chellen, has developed an open source tool to sort of mine the data, which is quite interesting. He just did that spontaneously, and we found out afterwards. And he's also imported the entire data set into the IBM's Many Eyes tool, which is provides lots of visualization tools for large data sets. So I'll just, you know, one view on that. You know, this is measuring citation rates, and it's divided up into large boxes per journal. Thank you. And so, you know, the size of the square indicates a larger citation rate. So, you know, you can explore and visualize the data in that way, and you can, it's a tool for sort of seeing patterns and stuff. So it's interesting to, again, see someone having done that. And yet another example is someone wrote recently, we're looking at correlations between some aspects of the data and wrote about that, so on their blog. So, you know, this is all good. This is the kind of thing we wanted to see happen. We wanted this kind of community feedback and response. So we've provided what we think is some pretty useful data. It is being used in various ways. So what happens next? We'd like to expand on this. So there are all sorts of ways we could improve the type of usage information that we're providing. The Frontiers series of journals, Frontiers in Neuroscience is their flagship, it does some very nice stuff, I think, in this space and providing information about time spent on articles. Someone else got in touch with us and said, you know, it's all very well this article level stuff, but as the point was made earlier, we need information at the level of individuals and institutions as well. And this person has done some of that on their own institutional repository, and in the red box at the bottom of providing citation data based on tools from Scopus and the Web of Science. Another example of this is the ACM, Association for Computing Machinery, who in their tools have provided some person-level information. But the point I just wanted to make there really is that we've got these independent initiatives going on, and what we really need to help provide information at the individual level is a unique identifier for individuals. Lots of people are talking about this. And I think it's really encouraging to see this initiative has just started, and it's really being spearheaded by Nature Publishing Group and Thomson Reuters. And it's an initiative to bring people together and develop a kind of one organization, independent of anyone else, to provide unique identifiers for authors, for researchers in general. So that's good to see. There are a number of other ratings we'd like to provide. Media coverage is something, you know, a lot of PLOS articles are covered in the media. It would be great to provide more information on media coverage, I think. And a number of other ideas, such as reputation metrics and so on. And so there's much more we can do. I haven't really touched on the business of using these things for filtering and navigation, but we should be incorporating, we plan to incorporate these metrics into search functionality. And we also want to develop an API on our site as well, so that other people can then sort of gather the data out from PLOS and use it in other ways. Deduplication is an issue with citation data. We'd love to see more, you know, expert analysis of the data. PIRUS 2, I think, was the initiative you mentioned about looking at article level usage data. So there is, I thought it got funded. maybe I'm wrong, but I think it got funded, and so it did get funded, we think. So this is an effort to create standards around article level usage. So we're very happy to see that. There's a question about, you know, we provide this set of data. Should we even think about collapsing it into one number? Maybe for marketing purposes, that would be a good idea to increase the interest in it. But it doesn't, in general, it doesn't seem like a particularly good idea because, you know, we started with the idea that, you know, measuring impact is a complex, multifaceted problem. Different indicators and metrics are going to be used for different things. And we'd love to see, you know, broader adoption within the community, but with also amongst publishers as well. And is there a role for a third party like Crossref, for example, in accumulating this data around articles, perhaps? So I just want to end then with a general point. Then, you know, what's potentially the broader significance of this kind of effort? And so, you know, this is a very simplified view of, you know, the life cycle of a research article. Research is done, the results get submitted to a journal, the article goes round and round a process of rejection, revision, review, and eventually gets published. And what's all important is the venue in which it gets published, the journal in which it gets published. So what we and you know, many others are now thinking about really is about the phase that happens after the article is published, and looking at, well, what impact has this article had using these metrics and other kinds of indicators. And that information is based not just on, you know, the opinions of a couple of reviewers who and the editor who make the decisions about where the article appears in the journal, but it's based on the activities of entire communities. So potentially, you know, very meaningful data. And so if that does happen, and this really begins to complement the activity and perhaps even challenge the traditional notions of what a journal does, and ultimately could make the business of publication a bit less painful than it is today in terms of the efforts that authors go through in order to get their work published in the highest impact journal they can get. So I'll end it there. Thank you very much.
Bob Campbell from Wiley Blackwell. That was a great talk, Mark. Thanks very much. You mentioned that very few people actually fill in a rating or comment post-publication, and this seems to be the problem with other post-publication peer review models. Do you see any way of motivating readers to improve that part of the process?
Yeah, I think we just haven't got it right yet. I think it's not as user friendly as it could be for a start off. So there's barriers associated with that, and I think we've made it probably, to be honest, a bit too complicated. So that's one thing. On the kind of incentive side, you know, you're right. There isn't really an incentive to do this kind of thing. However, if you could imagine tools, and you know, I sort of alluded to the idea of sort of user reputation systems. You could imagine sort of developing tools which begin to highlight, you know, who are the most active people on this site. You know, who is commenting in a way that people other people are valuing, and you know, you see the application of this type of approach. Not in the context of scholarship, but elsewhere on other sites, and so I think those are the kinds of things we could get into to try and improve it.
Any more questions? Everyone sort of really phased by it all. Oh, well, I have a question, Mark, and it's to do with that. As we put out an article-based data, and you see authors incorporating that in their web pages and various other CVs, what role do you see for standards of what is actually being measured and the time, particularly the time periods? Mm. I'm familiar with the counter standards at what you measure, but then what does this number actually mean? Is it the downloads for the past 2 months or the past 3 years?
Yeah.
Do you have a comment on that?
Well, so you know, there's just not that much activity at the moment in this space. You know, I think it's great what SSRM, I didn't know about what SSRM were doing actually until this meeting, so it's great to see that. But really, there hasn't been that much activity by publishers in providing usage data in a public way, and so I think there's loads of questions to look at, and I think the only way that's going to happen is through, you know, collaboration and discussion and sort of using experiences and things. So I think it's just too early to answer those questions yet. But what we are hoping is that by sort of taking the leap, if you like, then that we could encourage some of that. So
okay, we have two more questions. We obviously fired up some imagination. One here.
Hello, Mark. It's Richard Paddy from Smetico. Just a question about the statistic. I noticed on the slides briefly you went through, you didn't highlight it particularly, but the level of PDF downloads was actually significantly, it was an order of magnitude less than the number of HTML downloads.
Yeah.
I wondered if that was generally the case, and more importantly, you know, that seems to buck the trend really, as far as I'm aware, in terms of the journal's environment.
Yeah.
What might the reasons in your mind be for that?
I think there's a fairly simple explanation, and I think we're seeing basically the same thing that SSRN is seeing, which is that the first place you come to in SSRN's case is the abstract. In our case, it's the full text. So if you've done a Google search or a PubMed search or whatever, and you know, that's where most of the traffic comes from, then the first thing you hit is the full text. So inevitably, the hits to full text are going to be higher than they are to PDFs. And so, yes, there's definitely, I don't actually know what the overall excess is. I'm not sure if it's as much as an order of magnitude, but it's certainly, you know, 3-4 fold, definitely. So I think that's the explanation.
Salvatore Mele from CERN. Greg has shown us that when downloads become crucial for people, you need to have policing in. You have something else that you have shown while scrolling on the page, which is your star rating system and commenting system. Mm-hmm. Is there any policing of those? Is there any request from your authors for those to be policed? Which is your position overall? Thanks. Right.
So in terms of sort of commenting and rating for that matter, you know, we have a code of conduct, right? So we have guidelines, and they include, you know, you have to declare your competing interests, for example. So if you're an author on the paper, you know, it's going to be obvious anyway. But if for anything inappropriate that another user finds inappropriate, there's a flagging tool, right? So it's as on many sites, so you can just flag. If you've got a concern about a comment, you can flag it. In terms of, you know, how would you apply this to, I think there is potentially a role for community policing of usage data, you know, as a way of sort of highlighting what appears to be a bit odd, you know. That's probably as far as it should go, and then it's up to the whoever's in control of that, those log files, to decide whether they actually want to explore that or not. But I mean, I'd love to know more about the auditing stuff that you've done on SSRN as well, because that's clearly relevant to that issue. So,
did you want to say anything? One more? One final?
I have a question that relates to, so to speak, to access to the data that you generate, and it's maybe to both of you, so to you, Mark, and also Greg of SSRN. So, what I saw or heard or noticed was interesting in the sense that you have some policies, you do auditing, you have encouraged people to write, so to speak, studies based on the data that you have. And how far would you go if somebody else came and wanted to do something with your data in the sense of providing further services or doing something with it and transforming it into a widget or something that you could have on your computer, yeah? Because I noticed that to see the data, one would still presumably need to access your website or your pages. And what would you do if somebody else wanted to build a service on top of it?
I think we'd love it. So if you've got some ideas. So no, I mean, as an open access publisher, we're founded on, well, that's one of the principles is haven't really thought about it, to be honest, in the context of usage data, but so, you know, it makes sense that if someone comes up with a clever way of using usage data, then that's great. And we're, you know, if we'll highlight it, we'll help.
Yeah, we're wide open.
And if somebody comes up with, you know, a better mousetrap, then great. I mean, it's about making the content available and providing, as I said, the best means for measuring for each individual.
Well, thank you very much again, Mark. Excellent talk.